Today, our guest on NOBTS Conversations, Dr. Frank Cox, pastor at North Metro Baptist Church in Atlanta. Been there a while, huh?
Been there 34 years.
That's awesome. That's where I'd like to start with you, actually. Went there in 1980 as the pastor. It was a large, thriving mega church when you went, right?
Yeah. If 100 people's mega, yeah, it was a mega church. Still is a mega church. But, yeah, we run about 100 in Sunday school, a little over 100 when I went there. It was out there on the outskirts of Atlanta. Metropolitan Atlanta was moving out on it. And it was a rural setting. I had pasture land all around me, cows, looking in my window in my study, and great place to go to and a lot of potential. And I had to deal with what was sitting inside my church, you know, potential in the community.
Yeah.
But inside the church, it was a church that kind of gave up, kind of had just grown stale over the years. And was no longer growing. And so God just put me there at the right time that I could grow with it.
And been there 34 years.
34 years.
That's certainly not typical of what we see in most of our churches. Yeah. I'd like to talk to you about pastoral tenure, having a long pastoral tenure. Obviously, you think it's an important thing. Why is pastoral tenure or a long pastoral tenure? Why is that so important? What benefits have you seen in your own ministry from being at a place for an extended period of time? Yeah.
You know, Blake, when I was a seminary student here, I had these big visions of what God wanted to do, okay? I just knew, you know, when I sat in a growth class here at seminary, there'd be 100 students in there, and the professor would get up and say something along these lines, only three of you guys will ever pastor a super church. Now, that's what we called the mega churches back then, super churches. And so, you know, I was the guy sitting in the classroom that looked around the classroom and said, I wonder who the other two guys were. And, you know, and that, you know, because all of my life I have been told by my preacher dad, Frank, you can do anything if you'll just surrender it all to God. And so I had this big pencil that was on my desk at seminary, still behind my desk at church, that says, think big. And so, you know, in everything, I just knew that we have a big God, so you ought to have God-sized dreams. And it doesn't mean that every pastor is going to pastor a mega church. But what happened was I had a vision that God wanted to use me to be an evangelistic pastor. And so when I went to Pleasant Hill, I saw all the potential of Gwinnett County, which was hustle, bustle, grow. And I looked at all the potential of the area, did not look at what was sitting up inside my church. But what I found out is this, is not that I wanted to stay for 34 years, because there's been times along the journey I was open to making a move. But what I desired was that I wanted to be where God wanted me to be. I wanted to be obedient to God. And so to answer your question, what benefits have I seen? Number one, I have seen everything I wanted to experience as a seminary student, I've experienced in one location. I've pastored a small church, I've pastored a medium-sized church, I've pastored a large church, I've pastored what some may term as a mega church today. But the benefit far outweighs all the hardships you have to work through at different levels of that church growth.
Yeah.
The benefits are, I've invested my life in people, and they've invested their life back in me. I think not only do pastors build churches, I think churches build pastors. And so I've learned how to make decisions, and I've learned to live with my decisions. A few years ago, I was in an interview process for one of our national agencies. And a guy actually looked at me, sitting in the room. At that time, I had been pastor there 30 years. He looked at me and made this statement. And I looked at him like, are you kidding me? He looked at me and said, what do you bring to the table? All you've ever done is pastor one church for 30 years. And I look back at him and I asked this question back to him. I said, well, number one, how many pastors have you ever met that's been somewhere 30 years? And I looked at him then and said, sir, you got to understand, it's been an education for me. And I said, I've made decisions and I didn't run from my decisions. I made decisions, didn't let the next guy deal with my decisions. I've had to deal with them. So I've learned how to develop people skills. I've learned how to preach bad sermons and then some good sermons. I've learned what it's like to love people and for them to love me. I've watched kids born in this world. At least I was in the waiting room right after they were born.
Yeah.
And I have married those kids now. I'm standing there rejoicing with them when their kids are born. And so for a generation, pretty well a generation and a half, if not two generations, I'm the only pastor they've ever seen. The respect, the benefit of the doubt, the trust factors, it all comes from longevity.
Yeah.
What I also found out, Blake, is this. Churches that experience great growth over its life have always been marked by long-tenured pastors. If you come in and only stay 24 months, 36 months, I don't know what the average is now in Southern Baptist life, but it's still pretty short,
yeah,
compared to 34 years. And when you come in there and if you stay only 36 months, well, about 18 months, you're looking. And so when you look, you get sidetracked. And when you get sidetracked, you can't really determine what God wants for that congregation and helps and lead that congregation to what God desires for it. Mm-hmm. So I think the benefits is long tenured, you give stability to a church. I think long tenure means that you invest in people's lives. Long tenure means that you reap all the benefits that every pastor says he would really like to have one day. Mm-hmm. And so it's been a good thing for me. Along the journey, there's been bumps, mm-hmm. But you learn and you mature and you grow up through them. And so, I wrote the other day, adversity is a great teacher of life. And so in 34 years, yeah, ever so many years, there's a little bit of adversity, but yet God teaches us and grows us.
Yeah. You mentioned the benefits, and I said starting off that that's certainly not typical. Tom Rainer says average about 3 to 4 years, not 34, but 3 to 4
yeah.
Years. Why aren't there more? I know this is speculative on your part, but why aren't there more pastors that are committing themselves for long-term stays at a church? As you think about it, as you look at the landscape of churches.
People today. Skills. Mm-hmm. We don't think we ought to get criticism. Criticism's not always bad. Criticism sometimes is just the fact that somebody else has got a different idea. And sometimes you need to examine their ideas. That's what I mean by people skills, learning to listen and learning to, because they're just as engaged in that church as you are. The reason I believe that pastors move every so often is sometimes there's just churches that have programmed themselves to short tenures of pastors. Let me give you an example. I think the key to my church has been that I broke a cycle. Now, the pastor prior to me was there for 10 years, okay? So that's pretty, in today's climate, that's still a long pastorate. But every pastor before that was, short-timers. And I think what happens is when a pastor goes there, he's got these big dreams, big visions. And so everybody loves that because they want to dream too. But then he says, we're going to conquer the world. We're going to build buildings. We're going to, buy land. We're going to do, and all of a sudden, they, as a church, they stop in their tracks because that pastor, anytime you dream God's dream, there'll be, I like to say it this way, Blake, every time God lets somebody join your church, Satan will make sure somebody joins as well. And so when God's people start to rise up to fulfill the vision that God gives that pastor, Satan will make sure one or two of his people pop their head up and give resistance. And so the church may go through a little bit of resistance there for a little while, so the pastor gets discouraged. He hears the criticism. And so what he does is it's easier for him to put out his resume and to move on. Now, here's the problem. What he does then is he hands the leadership back over to the lay people, and they go another 18 months without a pastor. And God's never called them to lead the church. God's never given them the vision to lead the church. God's never put them in that pastoral authority role for the church. But they run the church in that interim time.
Yeah.
So they call another pastor. He comes in and says, man, we're going to win the world. We're going to build buildings. We're going to buy. He has the same type vision. He sees the potential. And after about two or three of those cycles where resistance, pastor puts out his resume, moves on, they hand it back over to the lay people. After about three or four of those times, when that pastor said, we're going to reach the world, they said, we've heard this before.
Yeah.
And so what happens is you condition a church to short-term pastors. And it takes a guy who will come along who will understand that God has strategically put him, placed him there, put him there. And that he says, my view of success in ministry is obedience to God. And if God's put me here, I'm not going to leave here until I know God has led me away. And if he'll stay, he'll begin to reap the benefits of what he really desires for his own life in following God.
Yeah. Yeah, certainly pastoral ministry has its challenges. I think that's one of the things I was going back and looking at what Tom Rainer said. He said about the 3 to 4 year mark is when the honeymoon ends.
That's right.
And then you begin to see the church honestly, see yourself honestly, and you begin to see the challenges, and sometimes they overwhelm a guy, and he leaves. As far as your pastorate, what have been some of the most challenging aspects of pastoring this church for you? And how did you deal with them?
Yeah, the most challenging for me is going where I've never been before. And what I mean by that, when I went there a little over 100 in Sunday school, I didn't know anything about church growth barriers, okay? I didn't realize when I got to 200 that I was going to start hitting a barrier, and I had to make adjustments. Didn't realize that when I got to 450 to 500, I was going to hit another barrier, and I was going to have to make some adjustments. I didn't realize 700. I didn't realize 1,000. And so with each one of those growth barriers, I had to grow up. I had to man up. I had to learn some new skills. I had to learn what to take hold of and what to turn loose of. And my church was very good about helping me acquire those skills. They, if I needed a consultant to come in and work with me, to teach me, they were all for it because they were going to reap the benefit of it. So the challenges that I've, the growth challenges have been tremendous. And because, you know, you can sit in a classroom at seminary all day long and take growth classes and all that kind of stuff that we did back then when I was in seminary. But until you get out there on the field and you start testing some of that theory and you find out what works and what doesn't work, and then all of a sudden you say, well, I'm not in school anymore. Where did I learn this? So I've learned how to run with eagles. I learned to see the guy that was just ahead of me in his church growing growth-wise. And I would go spend a week with him. I'd ask him every question I could ask. I'd watch what he did. I'd listen to what he did. That was one of the challenges. The other challenge was the discipline of study. Because I've learned that pastors who stay somewhere a long time, you know, you can't just keep going and, you know, preach a 3 years worth of sermons and go somewhere else preaching.
You have to study more.
And so my dad taught me. He being a pastor as well, he taught me. I asked him one day, I said, Dad, how you stay somewhere a long time? He said two things. He said, get in your study and study, pray, and he said, and love your people. And so I've had to grow up. One day, Blake, I was sitting at my dad's house on Sunday. My dad, the last 15 years of his life, 20 years of his life, he was a member of my church. He had retired from Georgia Baptist Convention. He moved his membership to my church, said I could spend his money better than anybody because I always have. And so my dad sat there. One day I was discouraged. One Sunday I was really discouraged. Everything at the church was going good. And I had people show up to church. They'd stand in worship. They'd hold their hands up. They'd sway back and forth. And I'm sitting down there eating at the end of my dad's table. And he said, why are you down? I said, Dad, I said, they come. They fill the place up. They sway back and forth. They sing, all that. I can't get them to serve. Can't get them to give. And my dad, without skipping a beat, he looked at me and he said, well, what are you going to do with them? You reached all of them. And at that point, my preaching changed. Instead of preaching salvation every Sunday, I started preaching series of messages. I started growing them up. I started taking people from where they were and try to make disciples out of them. All of a sudden, everything that I was discouraged about began to fall by the wayside because those people begin to mature in the faith and begin to step up. So I had to learn how to preach, study. I've had to learn how to overcome the growth barriers.
That's good. I know for you personally, One of, if not the most challenging aspect of your life was the loss of your wife, walking through that journey. Let me ask you this way. What did you learn about God walking through that difficult journey?
He's trustworthy. He's faithful. You know, a few years after Debbie died, immediately after Debbie died, I sat down one day and said, I'm going to write a book on this. And I didn't have anything to say. And so I put the pen down. And about 11 years later, I picked the pen up one night, 11:30 at night, and just started writing. And it just poured out of me. And what I learned, Blake, over those years was this. Charles Haddon Spurgeon has a great statement. And the statement is, God is too good to be unkind. God is too wise to be mistaken. And when you cannot trace his hand, that's when you learn to trust his heart. And when I look back over that experience, one of my friends in life, God, it was fortunate for me, God just put me with Jerry Falwell. And Falwell wrote the foreword to my book, and Falwell said the chapter on the diamonds is worth the whole price of the book. And I learned five quick diamonds. One is God is sovereign. While I couldn't see everything, when we first knew of the brain tumor, not knew it was a brain tumor, but knew of the effects of the brain tumor, mm-hmm. was when I was a student here, and Debbie would work in the registrar's office, and she'd come home and there'd be tingling in her left arm. And so then 2 years after we graduated, she was pregnant with our son, Stephen, and that's when she had a grand mal seizure. But we still didn't find the tumor because they were limited what they could do until about he was two, Stephen was two, so another 2 years went by, and that's when we found the brain tumor. Mm-hmm. But even when I didn't know and Debbie didn't know about the brain tumor, God knew. I've learned about the sovereignty of God, and that is simply this. My definition of sovereignty of God is this. God does what he pleases, and he's always pleased in what he does. Mm-hmm. And so while I may have not liked my circumstances, God was sovereign God doing his work. I learned, second of all, about God is salvation. You know, every man's greatest need is Jesus. Amen. And we worked through Debbie's salvation. Every person who goes through a terminal illness will deal with their salvation. Even though they may have accepted Christ back as a child or as mm-hmm. a teenager, but when they know death is coming, they want to be sure they're right with God. And, you know, and Debbie struggled with that a little bit. And so we nailed down her salvation. And you know, I had it caused me to struggle until a preacher buddy of mine by the name of Ike Reichard said, you know, even John the Baptist, when they were about to behead him, he called his disciples, says, you go to Jesus and said, are you the one? You know, make sure. And just a few days early, he says, there's the one who takes away the sin of the world. Then he said, make sure he's the one. Yeah. And so everybody deals with that. So God is salvation. I've learned that God is solution. Whatever problems you got, God is there. Mm-hmm. I found out that God is our strength. You know, he says, Paul has had that malady and said, Lord, can you take it away from me? And he said, no, my grace is sufficient for you. Well, I've learned about the sufficiency of God's grace. Mm-hmm. And the last thing I learned that really taught me during that time, God taught me, was the fact that he was sensitive. He would meet mm-hmm. every need I would have in my life. For me, why he did it for me, I do not know. 3 months after Debbie passed away, I wasn't looking, but God brought Mary into my life. I was raising a 4-year-old son at that time that I didn't know how to bathe, didn't know how to feed. I met every single school teacher in Gwinnett County. All the kids would come to church on Sunday with their school teachers in tow, saying, hey, Pastor, here's my teacher. She's never been married. And every grandmother brought their old maid granddaughters and, you know, and said that she's never been married. I won't say, well, let me tell you why she hadn't been married. But anyway, you know, I met all the single people in Gwinnett County, all the single women. And God just one Sunday put Mary there. And so I learned that he's sensitive. He'll meet every need you have. So when you don't like your circumstances and you can't trace the hand of God, you really wonder what God's up to. Believe me, as Spurgeon said, that's when you can trust his heart. Mm-hmm. And so I've learned that God's faithful and I can trust his heart.
Yeah. One more question on that. I'll get you out of here with this. When you're hurting like that, how do you keep ministering to people? How do you keep preaching as you're hurting like that? Because, you know, the human inclination is to just go off and hurt. Mm-hmm. But then how do you minister to others while you're dealing with that yourself?
through transparency. You know, one of my preaching professors, and I know you're a professor of preaching, one of my preaching professors says, you should never get up and never share about your life, da-da-da-da-da.
Really?
Yeah. And I found that's the greatest connection point. Mm-hmm. And it was somewhat easy for me to preach during the pain, because not only was I suffering, my church was suffering. Mm-hmm. You got to understand, I went through a rough time turning my church around. They were on me. I mean, they were trying to fire me. They came to me one night, a group of 13 men who have never heard me preach, but they, just because their name was on the church roll. And they gave me three or four reasons for my dismissal. One was because of my wife's brain tumor. I could not be effective as a pastor. That's the kind of people I inherited. Then I was too good at reaching people in the community. I preached with power and anointing, and they thought I had talked about somebody in one of my sermons. Well, they were right on that one. But the bottom line was, my church had watched me and my wife walk through the sickness plus the pressure of the church. Mm-hmm. They were hurting. And so I was able to stand up, and I preached a lot on the grace of God, the healing of God, the being able to trust God. And I would stand in my pulpit, and I'd say, folks, I know this is God's word, and it's trustworthy. I want you to know I'm struggling with this right now. And they would amen, because they understood. They were struggling with it. Yeah. And so we knew that God had us on a journey. And so I found it to be, I don't want to say easy, because it was painful. Mm-hmm. But I found it to be some of the most fruitful preaching, through transparency and belief that the word of God is the word of God, and it's trustworthy. Yeah. It will never lead you astray nor down, but allow you to fall by the wayside. So I just preached the word and was transparent.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate your transparency here. I appreciate your ministry. Great example for others, young pastors, old pastors alike. So we appreciate that. Thank you for being here today.
Thank you for letting me be here.
Pray that God would keep blessing you.
Thank you.